Right, I just had a few words to say about Leon 3X Davis, the person who is allegedly the true perpetrator of the crimes, the killing of Malcolm X, the shooting of Malcolm, that Muhammad Aziz, the one surviving person of Aziz and Khalil Islam, Norman Butler and Thomas Johnson, the one surviving person who was allegedly wrongfully convicted for Leon Davis's crimes. Now, just to recap, two men who were recently exonerated, Butler and Johnson, Muhammad Aziz and Khalil Islam, on the grounds that they were wrongfully convicted for the killing of Malcolm X.
Muhammad Aziz and Khalil Islam were convicted 55 years ago for the 1965 murder of Malcolm X. And now, the men once known as Norman 3X Butler and Thomas 15X Johnson will have their names cleared.
Thomas Johnson, Khalil Islam, died in 2009. And the man who allegedly committed the true shotgun assassin, the person who allegedly committed the crime that Khalil Islam was blamed for, wrongfully convicted for, William Bradley, aka Al-Mustafa Shabazz, he passed away in 2018. So we have Thomas Johnson, Khalil Islam dead, as well as the person who allegedly is the true perpetrator of the crimes for which he was wrongfully convicted, also dead. On the other hand, we have still alive Muhammad Aziz, who, as you've probably seen in the news, is trying to claim $40 million compensation. That is his lawyers, David Shanies and Deborah Francois, are in the process of trying to sue the state of New York for $40 million.
Muhammad Aziz, who was wrongfully convicted of murdering Malcolm X, is suing the city for $40 million. Aziz, who is now 84 years old, filed the lawsuit today, according to the New York Times.
But what is intriguing about all of this is that the true perpetrator, so-called true perpetrator, of Muhammad Aziz's crime, or the crime for which Muhammad Aziz was wrongfully convicted for, namely Leon 3X Davis, he is the one of the three shooters whose ultimate fate we know the least about. We all know that of the five-person hit squad, or six-person hit squad if you count Linwood X Cathcart, that went into the Audubon Ballroom, only three of them were shooters. Not allegedly, Talmadge Hayer, who was convicted for the crime. We all know what he looks like. We've seen him in both photographs as well as in, you know, interviews. He was one of the shooters. The shotgun man, who is alleged to be Bradley, but as I've raised in a previous video, questions as to whether we can rightfully claim Bradley is the shotgun man. Nevertheless, we also have film footage as well as photos of Bradley, who died, as I said, in 2018. What is really intriguing about the three shooters is that Leon Davis is the only one that we don't have even a photograph of, and we know the least about. With all the attention that is on Muhammad Aziz as the one surviving wrongfully convicted exoneree, there ought to be a corresponding attention and interest in Leon Davis, if for no other reason than that he's the one person of the three shooters we don't even have a photo of. So you would have thought that, number one, that the top priority of all Malcolm X scholars and researchers, whether it's people like Carl Evans or Omar Shabazz or Zach Kondo, Paul Lee, even the people who wrote these books, Les Payne, Tamara Payne, obviously Les Payne died, the number one focus of all Malcolm X scholars and researchers should be in trying to find out whatever happened to Leon Davis, and at the very minimum, what he looks like. And yet, as I said, not only do we have this kind of peculiar situation where Muhammad Aziz is involved in this high-profile effort to secure compensation for what he would have the world believe are Leon Davis's crimes. But the strangest thing about Muhammad Aziz, and I'm sure you've noticed this, is that he has never once mentioned the name Leon Davis or displayed any kind of resentment that here is this FOI from Mosque number 25, Leon 3X Davis, who allegedly committed the crimes for which he, Muhammad Aziz, was wrongfully convicted for, and yet he spent the rest of his life, and as far as we're aware, may still be alive now, out of prison, a free man, for a crime that Muhammad Aziz went to prison for. And yet you have never seen Muhammad Aziz display anything like animus or resentment, or even mention the name of Leon Davis. For instance, if you remember in the Central Park 5 case, when the true perpetrator of the assault on Trisha Meili was known, a Latino gentleman, I've forgotten his name, there was an effort to try to get, in addition to exonerating the Central Park Five, there was a lot of focus on trying to bring to justice, obviously, the true perpetrator. And yet, the guy who later admitted that he was the guy who actually assaulted and raped and nearly murdered Trisha Meili, the victim in the Central Park Five jogger case. And yet, we have a man, Muhammad Aziz, who is suing New York City for $40 million for his wrongful conviction. We have affidavits from Talmadge X Hayer that allegedly identify the true perpetrator of the crimes for which Muhammad Aziz was wrongfully convicted for. And yet no one seems in the least bit interested in trying to track down or determine the ultimate fate of Leon Davis, the man who allegedly committed Aziz's crimes, but also the one of the three assassins about whom we know the least, and who correspondingly ought to be the focus of efforts of historians and researchers to locate him. Now, I've been on the internet looking for Leon Davis in the Plainfield, New Jersey, or Newark, New Jersey area. In fact, if you run a Google search for the name Leon Davis on websites like ancestry.com, if you try to do a search for a Leon Davis in either the Plainfield, New Jersey area, or Newark, New Jersey, or in New Jersey in general, you will turn up a number of names of people who are in their 80s, 70s or 80s, who quite possibly are the real Leon Davis. In addition, as I showed in that the video on that sought to establish that Thomas Johnson had a connection to the Newark Mosque, that document that showed the list of people from Newark, New Jersey who visited Thomas Johnson in prison. If you look at this part of the document that gives the name of Leon Davis and his home address of 166 Mill Street in Plainfield, New Jersey, I think, there's also the name of his brother, Earl Davis, who also shared the same address, 166 Mill Street in New Jersey. I've also done a number of Google searches for Earl Davis in the Newark, New Jersey area, and again, you do turn up a number of individuals in their 70s or 80s who may well be the brother of Leon Davis, Earl Davis. Now, there's another thing that I found also quite interesting in the Abdurrahman Muhammad documentaries, or the Who Killed Malcolm X Netflix series, and I'm sure you will have also picked up on it. You remember when Abdurrahman Muhammad goes to Newark, New Jersey, to interview some of the former members of Mosque Number 25, some of the old heads from Mosque Number 25. Now, one of the individuals that Abdurrahman Muhammad interviews is a guy called Earl Sadiq. You might have noticed that of all the Mosque Number 25 old heads, Earl Sadiq was the most sort of belligerent or combative of all of them. When confronted with questions by Abdurrahman Muhammad as to whether efforts should be made to try to, you know, bring the killers of Malcolm to justice.
It's in the history book. Leave it there. Move on.
And Earl Sadiq kept saying things like, you know, leave it alone. You know, leave the whole Malcolm X case alone. You know, you know, what happened in the past is in the past. You know, words to that effect.
I mean, it says, let old dogs sometime lie. Mm-hmm. And you don't stir up, you know, what they say.
And he also said things like, you know, I had nothing to do with it then, and I had nothing to do with it now.
I didn't have to do with it then, I have nothing to do with it now. I moved forward.
Now, what is so interesting about Earl Sadiq and his kind of belligerent and combative behavior in the interview, in the interviews that Abdurrahman Muhammad did with him, is that it kind of got my head, kind of my brain turning as to, why would Earl Sadiq say something like, I had nothing to do with it then, and I have nothing to do with it now, even though Abdurrahman Muhammad hadn't, like, accused him of anything?
I've seen things that you haven't seen, no things that you don't know. So you got to be careful when you try to pull up those things. There's a lot involved in these things. Leave it alone.
When I took a kind of a closer look at those interviews, and as well as just generally Earl Sadiq and what he looked like, something kind of piqued my curiosity. In one of my videos, I showed you these photographs from Mosque Number 25 of a karate squad that Talmadge Hayer was a part of. Now, one of the people in the photograph, when I looked at Earl Sadiq and then looked at this and looked at the photo again, I saw what I was convinced was a younger version of Earl Sadiq. If you look at this guy in the photo, he does bear a striking resemblance, or rather he looks like what might be the younger version of Earl Sadiq. And that kind of sort of made me, it kind of explained to me why Earl Sadiq is the most combative of those Mosque 25 old heads. It's highly likely that Earl Sadiq was close to Talmadge Hayer, as these photographs suggest, and that Earl Sadiq knows things about the Malcolm X assassination.
I've seen things that you haven't seen, no things that you don't know. So you got to be careful when you try to pull up those things. There's a lot involved in these things. Leave it alone.
Without his realizing it, Abdurrahman Muhammad was actually interviewing somebody who may well in fact know a thing or two about the Malcolm X assassination. And I think researchers or those who are curious about the Malcolm X case should try to track down Sadiq, because I think Sadiq is an imam at one of the mosques in New Jersey. And I think it might be reward your efforts if you try to track down Sadiq and press him a bit more closely on whether he knew Talmadge Hayer in the light of these karate photos in which a younger Earl Sadiq appears. Could Earl Sadiq be the Earl Davis in this hospital log document? I don't know. I mean, I asked Lance Shabazz, he told me no, that it isn't. And obviously I tend to trust Lance Shabazz. I think he's an honorable person for the most part. I'm going to put up these photos again, because it's possible that Leon 3X Davis is one of the individuals in the karate uniforms in these photos. given the fact that that Muhammad Aziz is pursuing a multi-million dollar settlement for what he would have the world believe are the crimes that were committed by Leon Davis, but for which he was wrongfully convicted, it's a very strange thing that Muhammad Aziz has never displayed any animus that one would have expected to see towards the man, Leon Davis, alleged person, that lived his life in freedom, all the while knowing that there is a man in prison, Muhammad Aziz, who is in jail doing time for the crimes that I committed. It's a very strange thing that Muhammad Aziz shows not the slightest animus or resentment at Leon Davis. And as far as I'm concerned, it is yet more proof that Muhammad Aziz is guilty. The fact that he never ever once brings up the name of the true perpetrator of the crimes for which he was wrongfully convicted.